Because we're on page 8, 1680. 44 years after the settlement of Connecticut, the assembly forward answers to the inquiry of the Lords of the Committee of Colonies, wherein they say, there are but few servants and fewer slaves, not above 30 in the colony. There come sometimes 3 or 4 blacks from the Barbados, which are sold for 22 slash each. Great care is taken of the instruction of the people in the Christian religion by ministers, catechizing, and preaching twice every Sabbath, and sometimes on lecture days, and also by masters of families instructing their children and servants, which the law commands them to do. 1701, the Society for the Propagation of the Gospel in Foreign Parts was incorporated under William III on the 16th day of June 1701, and the first meeting of the Society under its charter was the 27th of June of the same year. Thomas Lord, Bishop of Canterbury, Primate and Metropolitan of all England, was appointed by His Majesty the First President. This society was formed with the view primarily of supplying the destitution of religious instructions and privileges among the inhabitants of the North American colonies, members of the established Church of England, and secondarily an extending the gospel to the Indians and Negroes. It had been preceded by a company incorporated by Charles II in 1661 for the propagation of the gospel among heathen nations of New England and the parts adjacent in America, which, however, did not accomplish much. The design for the times then, for the present, and the necessities of the colonies being too narrow, the Honorable Robert Borg was first president of this company, and it was his connection with this society which led him to a deeper interest in the defense and propagation of the Christian religion. And he therefore left in his will an annual salary forever for the support of 8 sermons in the year, for proving the Christian religion against notorious infidels, and he requires that the preachers employed shall be assisting to all companies and encouraging them in any understanding for propagating the Christian religion in foreign parts. The Society for the Propagation of the Gospel in Foreign Parts entered upon its duties with zeal, being patronized by the King and all the dignitaries of the Church of England. They instituted inquiries into the religious condition of the colonies, responded to by the governors and persons of the best note, with special references to episcopacy, and they perceived that their work consisted of 3 great branches: the care and instruction of our people settled in the colonies, conversion of the Indian savages, and the conversion of the Negroes. Before appointing missionaries, they sent out a traveling preacher, the Reverend George Keith, an itinerant missionary who associated with himself the Reverend John childbirth. Mr. Keith preached between North Carolina and Piscataqua River in New England, a track about 800 miles in length, and completed his mission in 2 years and returned and reported his labors to the society. The annual meetings of this society were regularly held from 1602 to 1819. 118 sermons preached before it by bishops of the Church of England, a large number of them distinguished for piety, learning, and zeal. The society still exists. The efforts of the Society for the Religious Instruction of the Negroes were briefly as follows. In June 1702, the Reverend Samuel Thomas, the first missionary, was sent to the colony of South Carolina. The Society designed he should attempt the conversion of the Yamasi Indians, but the governor, Sir Nathaniel Johnson, appointed him to the care of the people settled on the three branches of Cooper River, making Goose Creek his residence. He reported his labors to the society and said that he had taken much pains also in instructing the Negroes and learned 20 of them to read. He died in October 1706. Dr. Lejeune succeeded him in 1706 and found parents and masters imbued with much goodwill and a ready disposition to have their children and servants taught the Christian religion. He instructed and baptized many Negroes and Indian slaves. His communicants in 1714 arose to 70 English and 8 Negroes. Dr. LeBeau died in 1717 and was succeeded permanently by Reverend Mr. Ludlam, who began his mission great diligence. There were in his parish a large number of Negroes, natives of the place, who understood English well. He took good pains to instruct several of them in the principles of the Christian religion and afterwards admitted them to baptism. He said, the masters of them would heartily concur to forward so good a work. All those who have been born in the country might, without much difficulty, be instructed and received into the church. Mr. Ludlam continued his labors among the Negroes and every year taught and baptized several of them. In 1 year, 11, besides some mulattoes. The Indian War checked the progress of the Society's mission for several years. The parishes of St. Paul's, 1705, St. John's, 1707, St. Andrew's, and St. Bartholomew's, 1713, St. Helen, 1712, received missionaries, Mr. Hassel was settled in the name parish. And inhabitants were 565 whites, 950 Negroes, 60 Indian slaves, and 20 free slaves that were Negroes. Reverend Gilbert Jones was appointed missionary of Church Christ Parish, 1711. He used great pains to persuade the masters and mistresses to assist in having their slaves instructed in the Christian faith, but found this good work lay under difficulties as yet insuperable. He wrote thus concerning this matter: though laboring in vain, be very discouraging. Yet, by the help of God, I would not cease my labors, and if I shall gain but one proselyte, shall not think much of all my pains. He was succeeded in 1722 by a Reverend Mr. Parnell. 2 years after, he reported in his parish 440 free born and above 700 slaves, some of which understood the English tongue, but very few know anything of God or religion. In the parish of St. George, taken out of St. Andrew's, the church stands 28 miles from Charleston, 1719. Mr. Peter Tuskey was sent missionary, but soon removed to Maryland. The Reverend Mr. Barnum succeeded him in 1723. A year after his arrival, at Christmas, he had near 50 communicants, and what was remarkable, 17 Negroes. He baptized several grown persons besides children and Negroes belonging to Alexander Skeet, Esquire, the Reverend Mr. Taylor, missionary at St. Andrew's Parish in South Carolina, reported to the society. The great interest taken in the religious instruction of their Negroes by Mr. Hague and Mrs. Edwards, and their remarkable success, 14 of whom on examination he baptized. The clergy of South Carolina, in a joint letter, acquainted the society with the fact that Mr. Skeen, his lady, and Mrs. Hay, his sister, did use great care to have their Negroes instructed and baptized, and the Reverend Mr. Bernard, missionary, had baptized 8 Negro children belonging to Mr. Skeen and Mrs. Hay. And he writes to the society that at once he had 19 Negro communicants. Mr. Newman was sent as a missionary to North Carolina in 1722. He reported sometime after that he had baptized 269 children, one woman and 3 men, and 2 Negroes, who could say the creed, the Lord's Prayer, and 10 commandments, and had good sureties for their further information. The Reverend Mr. Beaker, missionary in Pennsylvania in 1723, reported that he had baptized 2 Negro slaves. And in 1709, Mr. Huddlestone was appointed schoolmaster in New York City. He taught 40 poor children out of the society's funds, and publicly castigated in the steeple of Trinity Church every Sunday in the afternoon. Not only his own scholars, but also the children, servants, and slaves of the inhabitants, and above 100 persons usually attended him. The society established also a catechism school in New York City in 1704, in which city there were computed to be about 1,500 Negro and Indian slaves. The society hoped their example would be generally followed in the colonies. Mr. Elias Mim, a French Protestant, was appointed catechist, who was very zealous in his duty, and many Negroes were instructed in baptizing. 1712, the Negroes in New York conspired to destroy all the English, which greatly discouraged the work of their instruction. The conspiracy was defeated, and many Negroes taken and executed. Mr. Noel School was blamed as the main occasion of the barbarous plot. Barbera's plot. Two of Mr. Mew's school were charged with the plot. One was cleared and others proved to have been in the conspiracy, but guiltless of his master's murder. Upon full trial, the guilty Negroes were found to be such as never came to Mr. Moore's school. And what is very observable, the persons whose Negroes were found most guilty were such as were the declared opposers of making them Christians. In a short time, the cry against the instruction of the Negroes subsided. The governor visited and recommended the school. Mr. Noon died in 1722, much regretted by all who knew his labors. He was succeeded by Reverend Mr. Wetmore, who afterwards was appointed missionary to Rye in New York. After his removal, the rector, church wardens, and vestry of Trinity Church in New York City requested another catechist. There being about 1,400 Negro and Indian slaves, a considerable number of them had been instructed in the principles of Christianity by the late Mr. Noel and had received baptism and were communicants in their church. The society compiled with this request and sent over Reverend Mr. Colvin in 1726, who conducted the school with success. Mr. Honeyman, missionary in 1724 in the province Rhode Island, had baptized in 2 years 80 persons, of which 19 were grown, 3 Negroes and 2 Indians and 2 mulattoes. In Narragansett, the congregation was reported to be 160, 1720, with 12 Indian and black servants. At Marblehead, the missionary reported 1725, having baptized 2 Negroes, a man from 25 years old and a girl 12, and that a whole family in Salem had conformed to the church. The society looked upon the instruction and conversion of the Negroes as a principal branch of their care, esteeming it a great reproach to the Christian name that so many thousands of persons should continue in the same state of pagan darkness under Christian government and living in Christian families as they lay before under in their own heathen countries. Society immediately, from their first institution, drove to promote their conversion, and in as much as their income would not enable them to send numbers of catechists sufficient to instruct the Negroes, yet they resolved to do their utmost and at least to give this work a mark of their highest approbation. They wrote, therefore, to all their missionaries that they should use their best endeavors at proper times to instruct the Negroes, and should especially take occasion to recommend it zealously to the masters to order their slaves at convenient times to come to them that they might be instructed. These directions had a good effect, and some hundreds of Negroes have been instructed, receiving baptism, and been admitted to the communion, and lived very orderly lives. The history of society goes on to say, it is a matter of commendation to the clergy that they have done thus much in so great and difficult a work. But alas, what is the instruction of a few hundreds in several years with respect to the many thousands uninstructed, unconverted, living, dying, other pagans it must be confessed. What hath been done is as nothing with regard to what a true Christian would hope to see effected. After starting several difficulties in respect to the religious instructions of the Negroes, which do not exist at the present time, but in a very limited degree, it is said, but the greatest obstruction is the masters themselves do not consider enough the obligation which lies upon them to have their slaves instructed. And in another place, society have always been sensible the most effectual way to convert the Negroes was by engaging their masters to countenance and promote their conversion. The Bishop of St. Asaph, Dr. Fleetwood, preached a sermon before the society in the year 1711, setting forth the duty of instructing the Negroes in the Christian religion. The society thought this so useful in discourse that they printed and dispersed abroad in the plantations great numbers of that sermon in the same year, and in the year 1725, reprinted the same and dispersed again large numbers. Bishop of London, Dr. Gibson, to whom the care of the plantations abroad as to religious affairs was committed, became a second advocate for the conversion of the Negroes and wrote two letters on this subject, the first in 1727, addressed to masters and mistresses of families in the English plantations abroad, exhorting them to encourage and promote the instruction of their Negroes in this Christian faith. The second, in the same year, addressed to the missionaries there, directing them to distribute the said letter and exhorting them to give their assistance towards the instruction of the Negroes within their several parishes. The society were persuaded this was the true method to remove the great obstruction to their conversion, and hoping so particular an application to the masters and mistresses from the See of London would have the strongest influence, they printed 10,000 copies of the letter to masters and mistresses, which was sent to all the colonies on the continent and to all the British islands in the West Indies, to be distributed among the masters and families and all other inhabitants. Society received accounts that these letters influenced many masters and families to have their servants instructed. The Bishop of London soon after wrote an address to serious Christians among ourselves to assist the society for propagating the gospel and carrying on this work. The letters of Dr. Gibson referred to for their intrinsic excellence and as an indication of the state of feeling on the subject at the time they were written, render it proper that they should be inserted in this sketch. I have not been able to obtain a copy of Dr. Fleetwood's sermon. The Bishop of London's letter to the masters and mistresses of families in the English plantations abroad, in exhorting them to encourage and promote the instruction of their Negroes in the Christian faith, London, 1727. The care of the plantations abroad being committed to the Bishop of London as to religion affairs, I have thought it my duty to make particular inquiries into the state of religion in those parts, and to learn, among other things, that number of What number of slaves are employed within the several governments, and what means are used for their instruction in the Christian faith? I find the numbers are prodigiously great, and am not a little troubled to observe how small a progress has been made in a Christian country towards the delivering those poor creatures from the pagan darkness and superstition in which they were bred, and the making them partakers of the light of the gospel and of the blessings and benefits belonging to them, and which is yet more to be lamented. I find there has not only been very little progress made in the work, but that all attempts towards it have been by too many industriously discouraged and hindered, partly by magnifying the difficulties of the work beyond what they really are, and partly by mistaken suggestions of the charge which baptism would make in the condition of the Negroes to the loss and disadvantage of their masters. Just a moment.